Please welcome Dr. Eric Loomis, Associate Professor of History at the University of Rhode Island. Dr. Loomis specializes in the labor and environmental history of the United States, the history of capitalism and global trade regimes, and the American West. He is the author of A History of America in 10 Strikes, Empire of Timber, Labor Unions and the Pacific Northwest Forest, and Out of Sight, the long and disturbing story of corporations outsourcing catastrophe.
Hello. It's great to see you. Thank you all for sticking around here. I want to just note how amazing each of those three plays were and really thank the actors and the writers and everybody who's put this amazing event on. And it's a real honor to be able to speak to you all here tonight. So what I'm going to do, I have about 10 minutes. And what I'm going to do is give you not a history of the labor movement. That's way too much in 10 minutes. But I want to put some of these critical issues that these plays develop into some historical context for you to understand how we can use the past to inform the present, to understand how the worker struggle of today has these connections in the past, and to give some inspiration in these struggles in which we are facing. And honestly, from the perspective of a labor historian, these are very interesting times. This is a very interesting moment. People are in the streets right now in ways that they have not been in a long time. These fights for racial justice, for Black Lives Matter right now, is a fight against racism, a fight against the oppression that people are facing. And this has a strong working class element that in the United States, an inherently racist nation, that the majority of people who are working class are people of color. And this is a fight against racism, but also a fight against the broad struggles of people to just make it, to people to live a decent and respectable life. And I think that we're really seeing this right now in this time of pandemic too. Right, that this is also a moment in which all of a sudden these workers that have gotten no respect, that are at the bottom of our pay scale, that are at the bottom of our sort of national scale of what workers are all of a sudden being declared essential, right? That these workers that suddenly are getting our attention in this pandemic, again, largely people of color, are people that have been struggling and dying on the job for years, right? That we in this nation have developed this idea of a hero at work, that these heroes, the police, fire, then EMTs, okay, the EMTs at least are heroes, but you know, that we have developed a kind of propaganda around who is heroes that we are supposed to think of as higher than everyday workers, the people who we are supposed to respect and admire. And all of a sudden, this has now been extended to so-called essential workers. But here's the thing about that, right? That you have, you know, police, fire, EMTs, the military, these are people who go into work expecting potentially dangerous things to happen. If you are a grocery store worker, if you are a meat packer, if you work picking crops, you didn't ask for your life to be put on the line. This is not what you bargained for. And moreover, these workers, even if they have unions, and some of the meatpacking plants are unionized, and some of the grocery stores are unionized, it's still a hard job. It's still a low-paid job that's often minimum wage or barely any higher. It's still a job in the meatpacking plants that is often consists of undocumented workers, that these workers that have been ignored or marginalized in America for decades are all of a sudden getting our attention, and we're saying, oh, you're a hero. Well, they didn't ask to be heroes. And moreover, if we believe they are heroes, we have to move beyond just thinking about this as a pandemic so that we can get our chicken or whatever, or check out at the grocery store, and give them the rights, fight for the rights in which they need, in which all workers need. And this is this issue of the pandemic and these Black Lives Matter protests are kind of a microcosm of the bigger picture that we are facing today, right? That, you know, 100 years ago and 120 25 years ago, especially, we faced a period of time when work in this nation was dirty, it was dangerous, it was low paid, there was all kinds of racial violence. It was called the Gilded Age. And this was a bad, bad period. This was a period in which people died all the time on the job. This is the period of the jungle, when Upton Sinclair wrote his famous book exposing the conditions in meatpacking plants. Well, today, 125 years later, 114 years later in this case, those conditions are barely any different than they were in the jungle. That's a story that tells us so much, that in the 30s, that those meatpacking plants that Upton Sinclair talked about, they unionized. The United Packing House Workers of America was one of the most progressive unions in the country, promoting black leadership at a time when there was, when a lot of unions still had a tremendous amount of racism within them. And this was a union that made the meatpacking plants safer. And then in the 1950s and the 1960s, the industry busted these unions by moving them out of Chicago and into places like Iowa, Nebraska, South Dakota, where there were not unions. And then they start bringing the most exploitable workers possible, in many cases undocumented, to these plants so they can recreate the situation of the jungle. And then they are so committed to this that there have been cases in which meatpacking plants, when these workers unionize, because Latino workers, Latin American immigrants, are oftentimes very open to unionization, much, much more so than white men. What happens is that they will call immigration authorities on themselves, pay those fines so they can deport the workers who have tried to unionize, right? That this is the kind of immorality they face. And even before COVID, these workers were cutting themselves on the job, they're working in horrible conditions, they're hurting themselves. This is very, very difficult, hard work. We need to, in this time of COVID, rethink our entire idea and tradition of work. And we have so much to go on, right? That we as a nation fixed that period of the Gilded Age in the 20th century, where we fought, people died even to create the middle class, to pull people up, to give you decent pay, good working conditions, a union contract, a vacation, and healthcare, and everything that the working class had in the 20th century. And in the last 40 to 50 years, it has been the singular goal of corporate America to take all of that back. And they've largely succeeded. The Supreme Court, completely controlled by right-wing conservatives that are absolutely 100% anti-union. Donald Trump's first Supreme Court nominee, Neil Gorsuch, became famous because he ruled as a federal appeals court judge. He issued a ruling that a trucker who left his truck on the side of the road in a snowstorm so he wouldn't freeze to death, that he ruled that it was okay for the company to fire that worker because he had broken the conditions of his contract by saving his own life. And moreover, not only did he make that ruling, but he tells jokes about it at right-wing conventions, right? He laughs that he made this ruling. These are the people that we face. Right? But yet, especially in the decade now, almost a decade since Occupy Wall Street, workers have increasingly come out. The left has reorganized itself, that you have Occupy, the Fight for 15, Black Lives Matter, the increasing social and economic justice demands that came through the Sanders campaign and even some of the other primary campaigns, that this is a moment in which people are making the kinds of demands that they haven't made in a long time. And in some ways, although we face enormous challenges, we also have tremendous possibilities. And last thing I'll say before we go to the Q&A is that when we think about this horrible time in which we're living right now, which unemployment skyrocketing, I want you to understand that yes, when the Great Depression happened in 1929, that laid the groundwork for the working class getting all of this stuff in the New Deal, the Social Security Act, the right to unionize, the minimum wage, overtime, all of these things. But it took years of struggle. 1929, Great Depression. 1932, Franklin Roosevelt's elected. 1934, the great year of strikes. 1935, the right to a union is finally truly granted in America. That's six long, hard years of poverty and struggle. And I mention this to say that the work that's being done now, even if it doesn't win right away, it's laying the groundwork for years of activism to come to demand justice, racial, economic, gendered, sexual, social, any kind of justice, that the work we do now will pay off down the road. So I'll go ahead and stop there, and we will enter into the Q&A for a few minutes. I thank you all for listening to me, and once again, thank all the actors and directors of these amazing plays.
Thank you so much, Dr. Loomis. That was a wonderful speech. I'm one of the co-directors of Pick Plays, and if you have any questions, just throw your question into the Q&A section. Just to start it off, going back to what you were mentioning at the beginning in regards to the police unions, I know everyone is really talking about that at the moment. What, in researching your book, in reading it, I was extremely, extremely distressed that almost every single strike that ever happens, either they bring in a private company like the Pinkertons, or the police are using extreme violence. Has there ever actually been a point where there's been solidarity with the police unions, and where do you see that going from here?
Yeah, I mean, the police have really never shown solidarity with other unions, and that's something to recognize. It is an interesting story. When the first time the police really tried to unionize was in 1919 in Boston, and it was a really remarkable potential thing in that, the reason to unionize, it was 1919, they had not received a pay raise since 1856. It's like a lifetime without a pay raise. And when they form these unions, and then the American Federation of Labor actually lets them in, the forces of order, the politicians and the employers, the newspapers, they really freak out. And the reason is because they had relied on the police to bust heads in strikes. And they feared that if the Boston police were allowed to unionize, they would start seeing solidarity with other workers. And so they went full on to bust that union. And they did. And the person who did it was Calvin Coolidge. And based solely on his union busting, he became the nominee in the 1920s, was the vice president of for the Republican Party. And then when Warren Harding dies, he becomes president. And strictly because he busted a police union. So there's this kind of moment where it seems like maybe there's this potential, but really it doesn't happen. I mean, the police, whether they're unionized or not, really have honestly never shown solidarity with workers. Occasionally, you know, if a city, tells the police to be neutral or something like that, yeah, that'll happen. They'll take orders. But in terms of stepping out and showing solidarity to other workers, the answer honestly is no.
Gotcha. We have an interesting question right here, and I might just preface it. It's probably because it was only 10 minutes. But the question is, I can't quite believe that Professor Loomis has passed by the most significant development in our labor movement in the last 30 years, namely the Wildcat teacher strikes of 2018, 2019, where nearly 500,000 teachers went on illegal strike and won hundreds of millions of dollars into public education from their reactionary state legislatures. What is his view of this phenomenal show of power?
Yeah, it's amazing, actually. It's truly amazing. It's a tremendous moment. And I think it shows a few things, actually. One is that the whole idea of a strike being illegal only really matters if there's somebody to replace you, right? I mean, when West Virginia teachers go on strike, who's going to go into rural West Virginia and teach for $35,000 a year? Like, no one's going to do that. Right. And so they have a tremendous amount of power. And a lot of these teachers have a tremendous amount of power. And I think what's really significant about the teacher strikes, but other actions, too, I want to point out, for instance, the role of Sarah Nelson and the Association of Flight Attendants ending the government shutdown by basically saying, like, we're not going to work, and starting to think about calling for a general strike and how effective that was, is that, part of what's happening today, right, is that we are in a world in which the vast majority of us, the 99%, are a few paychecks away or one paycheck away from homelessness, even if we have a good job. It's not a world anymore, I think, where maybe it was in the 1970s, where some people saw, union workers were like up here and the rest of us were down here, and there was this big gap. At this point, union or not, a lot of us are really struggling. And I think that there's a lot of sort of latent solidarity there that people don't necessarily know yet how to express that solidarity. But when you have teachers go on strike, or when, you know, during the government shutdown, and if you were flying and you saw these, TSA workers who, you know, you knew weren't getting paid and you were interacting with them, right? And you knew they were working for no money. There was a feeling like this is wrong, you know? And so it's a tremendous moment. And the other part of it that's so effective is that it's truly community unionism, right? That it's not just people striking because, you know, I want a 25% pay raise. They're striking for the children, right? They're striking so that, you know, rather than, go have to work a second job in the evenings, they can grade children, you know, they can grade their students' homework or sleep or do other things that, you know, that will prepare them to be a good teacher. And so absolutely, and I'm really glad that questioner brought that up. It was just an oversight on my part. It's a tremendously powerful moment, and I think has a ton of lessons for us going forward, and it's incredibly inspiring. And I certainly hope that continues here as we move forward in the next few years. Yeah.
Wonderful. Any comments on the Postal Service, the country's largest unionized workforce, now facing an existential threat?
Yeah, I mean, it's basically, you know, part and parcel of the Republican Party attack on labor unions, right? This is really, in many ways, the number one goal of the Republican Party is to destroy public sector unions. And that's been central to people like Scott Walker. It's certainly central to Donald Trump. And because the reason it was in part is the public sector unions give money to the Democratic Party. And that's really their biggest, gives workers power. You have a situation right now where Republicans force through this ridiculous pension plan in which the Postal Service, unlike any other agency in the government, has to prepay pensions decades in advance. And now Trump's talking about, you know, refusing to sign any bill that would actually fund the Postal Service. And it's hard to say what the long-term implications of that would be. I do suspect that something will happen, but there'll be some bill to at least save the Postal Service in part. But it's one of many disasters that's taking place that threatens to take thousands and thousands of middle-class jobs and turn them into poorly paid jobs. And it goes back. It's in the same ballpark as Reagan busting air traffic controllers or the many other destruction of unions that has happened over the last several decades, including, say, Scott Walker again in Wisconsin after he took power in 2011. So, yeah, it's a real disaster waiting to happen.
How do you see the looming economic downturn from COVID affecting labor rights in the 2020s?
Well, I think that, you know, I mean, I'm not going to romanticize poverty. I mean, people, you know, the unemployment, extra unemployment benefit has helped a lot of people out. It's quite a few people I know are making more money now than when they were working, which is a sign of how bad so many American jobs actually are. So right now, there's been this bridge. It's actually a good thing. Like, if people got money all the time from the government, we would have a lot less problems in our society. If that gets pulled away, you're likely to see a rise in evictions, homelessness, hunger, domestic violence, all of the social problems that come with poverty. It is a terrible, terrible thing. But at the same time, I do think that people are angry. People were angry even before this, right? And you see this rising movement on the left that is really stronger than it has been in decades, right? Really, in my view, since the 70s. And so you're already seeing that groundwork being laid. And I think that the legal response to labor rights from these right-wing courts that Trump and McConnell are putting in is not something to sneeze at. It's very real. I mean, they're gonna declare a lot of stuff that we are gonna do effectively illegal. But that was happening in the 1920s too. And then just a few years later, we have the right to unionize, we have the minimum wage, we have all these gains. And so the kind of pressure that you can put on politicians through strikes, also through voting, and through strikes, the combination of inside the electoral process and outside the electoral process is critical. You got to have both to win. That can make change rapidly. And I think that if we continue to build on the teacher strikes, the fight for 15, what's happening in the streets as we speak here tonight, that we can make a lot of incredible advances over the next few years, even though the odds are tough. The possibility is there for transformative change.
Great. And just to honor your time, last question. Your book is so thorough. I highly recommend everyone purchase this book, A History of America in 10 Strikes. I was extremely captivated by the very first strike that you mentioned, which is the Lowell Mill Girls, and forming some of the first unions and having almost quasi-anarchist literature even before Karl Marx. And was there anything specifically in your particular research as a historian yourself that surprised you, that interested you, and if you could go from there?
Well, you know, I've been doing this for so long, I don't know that I was surprised per se, but I think that one point that's really important, you bring up the Lowell Mill Girls, the second chapter focuses on the general strike of slaves, slaves freeing themselves during the Civil War. And the last chapter focuses on justice for janitors and Latino workers. And I think that that one thing I really want to emphasize here is that there's a vision in America that the worker, and if you read the New York Times, the Washington Post, or other big publications, when they want to interview workers, they're always white guys, right? And that is a very limited view of what unions have been, right? Many of the unions in this country and the workers in this country are not white. I mean, the actual existing working class is by far the most diverse part of our country. And I want the book to show that. I wanted the book to show how women had driven the labor movement, how African Americans had transformed work in America by ending slavery, and how the future of the labor movement is not just white men in Pennsylvania and Ohio. I mean, I want white men in Pennsylvania and Ohio to have good lives too. But the future of the American labor movement is not pandering to white men and moving the Democratic Party or the labor movement to be more conservative to appeal to socially conservative white men. That's a path of disaster. Future of the labor movement is as an intersectional, multicultural movement that centers on racial, gender, and economic justice together. Only through that combination can we win the rights that we all deserve going forward. Only through focusing on all of these things together can we bring justice to Americans. And I'm very encouraged, especially by younger people, by the ways in which they're increasingly centering all of these things together, not trying to say class is more important than race or race is more important than class, to bring these together into an intersectional movement that really has the potential to transform this nation in new ways. And so I really want to encourage everybody, watching this tonight to try to think about how they can move their own organizations in that direction. If they're not part of a union, how, through their own activism, whatever that looks like, union or not, to move this forward, to bring the fight against racism, against sexism, and against class discrimination into one large battle, that battle that we're seeing on the streets right now and that we've been seeing in various forms over the last decade. And so, to me, that's the big message to take out of my book, I hope, but also out of what I'm saying tonight.
Wonderful, thank you. We have a few questions that may not have been answered. Would you mind if we emailed them your way?
Sure thing.
Thank you so much, Mr. Loomis.
You bet, thank you.
Thank you.